The back musculature is organized into three main divisions: the superficial or extrinsic layer, the intermediate layer, and the deep or intrinsic layer. The superficial layer is composed of the trapezius, the latissimus dorsi, levator scapula, and the major and minor rhomboids. These muscles connect the upper limbs to the trunk of the body and produce and control their movements. The serratus posterior, superior, and inferior make up the intermediate layer. They assist in the movement of the ribs during inspiration. In the deep muscle layer, containing the splenius cervicis and capitis, as well as the erector spinae muscles, which include the iliocostalis, the longissimus, and spinalis, as well as the semispinalis and suboccipital muscles that lie deep to those, predominantly control the extension and rotation of the head and vertebral column. The majority of back muscles originate from locations along the posterior skull and vertebral column. Some of those originations include this prominent bump on the posterior surface of the skull called the external occipital protuberance, and here another at the posterior base of the temporal bone called the mastoid process. At the same level as the external occipital protuberance, there's a slight ridge that runs laterally along the back of the skull, referred to as the superior nuchal line. And just below that, there's another ridge called the inferior nuchal line. At the base of the skull, there's a large hole called the foramen magnum. This is where the spinal cord exits the cranial cavity and travels through the vertebral column, which is made up of 33 individual vertebrae. These are arranged in 5 regions along its length. There are 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 fuse segments make up the sacrum, and 4 fuse segments typically make up the coccyx. Vertebrae normally vary in size and other characteristics from one region to another, but their basic structure is the same. A typical vertebra consists of a vertebral body and a vertebral arch. The arch is composed of pedicles and a lamina, and projecting off the arch are 7 processes: 2 transverse processes, 1 spinous process, and 4 articular processes. The vertebral body and arch form an opening, called the vertebral foramen, and these successive foramen, stacked on top of each other, form the vertebral canal through which the spinal cord travels. When the vertebrae are stacked together, the superior and inferior vertebral notches form intervertebral foramina. This is where spinal nerves emerge from the vertebral column along with their accompanying vessels. And between the bodies of the stacked vertebrae are cartilaginous intervertebral discs. These provide protection and cushioning between the individual bones. Individual vertebrae demonstrate characteristic features identifying them as belonging to one of these 5 regions. Cervical vertebrae form the skeleton of the neck. They are the smallest of the 24 movable vertebrae, and the smaller size reflects the fact that they bear less weight than the larger vertebrae inferior to them. They contain distinctive transverse foramen in their transverse processes. These foramen allow the passage of vertebral veins and arteries, and they also typically have a bifid spinous process, meaning that it's separated into 2 parts as shown here. The 2 most superior cervical vertebrae are atypical. C1 is called the atlas. It's unique because it doesn't have a body or a spinous process. Instead, it has these lateral masses that articulate with and bear the weight of the skull. C2, called the axis, is the strongest of the cervical vertebrae. The atlas, which again carries the skull, rotates on the axis, as when a person turns the head to indicate no. The distinguishing feature of the axis is the blunt, tooth-like process called the dens. This serves as the pivoting point around which rotation of the head occurs. Thoracic vertebrae lie in the upper back and provide attachment for the ribs. As a result, their primary characteristic feature are costal facets. These are the articulation points between the thoracic vertebrae and the ribs. They also tend to have a more long and slender spinous process, as opposed to the lumbar vertebrae below them, which have shorter, broader spinous processes. Lumbar vertebrae are located in the lower back, and because of the increased weight they support, they also tend to have very large vertebral bodies. The sacrum is easily distinguishable as a large, triangular, wedge-shaped bone at the base of the vertebral column. There's an opening called the sacral canal that runs through the sacrum. This is continuous with the vertebral canal above it, and it transmits the inferior portion of the spinal cord. Along the medial line on the posterior surface of the sacrum, there's a ridge, referred to as the median sacral crest. This represents the fused spinous processes of the sacral vertebrae. Laterally, in either direction from the crest, you'll find a row of three or four pairs of sacral foramina, which allow for the exit of the posterior and anterior rami of the spinal nerves at that level.